Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Resonance Arcade. It's episode 20, and today we're talking about tools and mechanics in games.
Chris, what? Being such a tool, has said good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Oh, shut up. Does it matter?
Yeah.
Why? Why do you have to pick up on it? No one cares. Go on. What is it anyway? Is it night, then? Is that what you would refer to
good
this
evening?
As night?
Yeah, I would call this evening.
Look, I woke up late today, so
that's an excuse.
It was 9 o'clock or something, but in the morning. But anyway, yes, so hello everybody. Today's show we're talking about tools and mechanics in games, specifically things that aren't weapons, you know, things that help you get past certain objectives or allow you to gain access to special area, you know, secret areas or things like that. As you can see, we don't have any Stee today. His internet is again imploded. And Sam, that way. It's really weird, this. Not sure which way to point. Sam is still, obviously, can't turn his cam on, so we've got a nice little tool-related image for you.
Constructed by a tool as well.
Yes, yes. Not particular fans of Tool Time, by the way, or whatever it was called. Home Improvement, wasn't it, was it called?
Tool Time.
No, Tool Time was his show.
Tool Time was the show on
yeah, Home that was his show on the show that we were watching, which was Home Improvement. It was bad. It was terrible.
Yeah, okay. Had the kid who did the voice of young Simba was one of his kids. That's what I remember from about it. You know, from The Lion King?
Yeah.
Really?
I was just trying to think of something he says, but I can't have Simba.
Nothing.
Is that back
I just can't wait to be king.
Is that back when
no,
Disney
Dad, don't die.
Hire any known actors for their voices.
Yeah.
Anyway. Not really. They had some big actors. Anyway, off topic.
Yeah. So let's kick off with. Has anyone got anything specific they wanted to talk about with, for tools? I'm struggling a bit. I'll be honest with this one. As much as I can talk about games and mechanics and things like that all day, it's tools in specifically tools I struggle with, I think.
Well, we are going to talk about mechanics as well. I mean, let's be clear. We probably couldn't fill a show, or maybe we could, but we. We've not
have to
going
do quite
to fill
a bit
a show.
We'd have to do quite a bit of research, I think, if we were doing
tools. Yeah, with what I guess you described as the kind of non-combatant implements, like things which you use that don't involve actually beating someone over the head with it or shooting them with it.
Hmm.
But there's also mechanics as well, which is a huge one, really, when you think about it.
It's massive, and to be fair, if I'd have thought earlier on in the week, I'd have done a bit more research on mechanics, because there's a lot. There's a lot of times in games where I kind of get a little bit like that's brilliant, you know, that particular implementation is amazing, or it's a brand new mechanic that's really, you know, impressed me. And just started off one of the mechanics that that comes to mind straight away is anti-chamber, if you've played that. I think you have played that, haven't you, Lou?
I have played it, but I couldn't rebind the controls, so I couldn't play it properly.
Yeah, have you played that, Sam? Is it on the PlayStation? Anti-Chamber is a puzzle game. It was kind of, I think it was done as a game jam. It's another indie game, and it's really, really minimal. You know, there's not much in it. It's done in UDK, Unreal Engine, and it's you've got this kind of anti-matter gun, and you run around and kind of point it at different coloured blocks. And you absorb them into your gun, and then you can fire these blocks in different areas. They're only small little blocks, but you use them to solve different puzzles. But there's also times where you might some like Escher based kind of physics in there, and there's a lot of four dimensional type craziness in there as well. One of the moments you walk down a corridor, it's really early on in the game. It's quite confusing. You walk down a corridor, and then you have to basically turn back on yourself in order to complete that particular puzzle. But there's loads of these puzzles, and they kind of take you to the next area, and they've got a load more puzzles and some craziness in it. But anyway, one of the things is picking up these objects and putting it down. In terms of the game mechanic, it's a very simple game mechanic, but it's implemented in lots of different ways. You know, it's one of them is you have to use it to form like a path on a floor to get over a chasm, and then you get to another chasm and you try and do the same, but they just disappear, and then you have to use them in a slightly different way in order to get over the next chasm. Or you might use the blocks to fill in a jigsaw type thing on a wall, and then that kind of opens up the next part. Or you might use a block to block a door so it doesn't come down. And it's, you know, dead simple mechanic, but can be used in a million different ways, and I was really impressed when I played that game. It's really crazy ending as well.
I mean, I've not really played the game, but I know a lot about it, and I know that the guy who made it really wanted to play with people's conceptions.
Yeah.
So he wanted to kind of dispense with the whole idea that you kind of, you know, you'll walk around a corner and then you can walk back around the corner and you'll be back where you started. He wanted to dispense with that and have it so that you really had to think in ways which were not realistic in order to achieve.
Totally, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of things that have been done before in the game, but there's also a lot of new interesting kind of mechanics, and I don't want to go through too many of them because it will spoil it for anyone who hasn't played it.
I think the overarching mechanic of the game is that in itself, in that it plays with your conceptions of mechanics
and games tropes and all
that. I assume it's on Steam. Does it require
it's a really minimal game.
It's probably on PSN by now. It's very cool. I thoroughly enjoyed it. It's not particularly long, but you can take a long time doing it because the puzzles are so weird. Some of the puzzles, again, it's like I explained with Portal a while back. I felt like I broke the game a number of times when I played Portal, and I felt the same when I played Antichamber. And it felt like, I think I've talked about it before on the show, actually, but I might even have showed some footage. It's, yeah, really, really minimal, but really cool. And I would recommend it to anyone who likes puzzle games and wants something slightly different. Definitely.
And who is right-handed.
Yes, yeah.
If you're left-handed, you're fucked.
I mean, the thing is, the whole game, it's different because, you know, most games where you enter the game, you press escape or you press start or whatever on your control pad and you get a menu up. One of the first things that you do is the menu is actually on the wall in the first room on the game, so that if you can rebind your controls, it would be in there. And I don't know if you can rebind anything at all. Can you not?
Yeah.
It's a bit weird. But there isn't that many left-handed people in the world, so fuck y'all.
What's the ratio? I bet Lou knows.
I don't.
Oh, I thought you might. It's a sort of little factoid that I thought you might know.
One in seven or something like that?
Yeah, that's a lot. That's a billion people, man.
Yeah.
But out of that, how many are gamers? Not many. Lou is the only left-handed.
I'm not even left-handed. I'm ambidextrous, but I play left-handed.
Has to be somewhat better, doesn't he? All the time.
Yeah. That's,
I can use both hands. So why are you complaining then?
Because that's not what ambidextrous means.
Yes, it does. It means you can do things equally with both hands.
No, it doesn't. It means you can become proficient with both hands. It doesn't mean to say that if you learn to do something with this hand, you can automatically do it with this hand. It doesn't work like that.
No, I didn't.
That's a mechanic.
Okay. Well, I think everyone on the planet's ambidextrous then, surely, because you can learn.
You can learn, but you can't become equally proficient with both hands.
You could if you spent an equal amount of time.
No, it doesn't work like that. You'll have a dominant side.
Feels wrong.
If you were like 2 years old and then you made a strange decision for a baby to make, and were like, "I am going to be ambidextrous," and then spent half your time when you were writing with your right hand and half your time writing with your left hand. I don't know.
But your handwriting would be different with each hand as well, though, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, in terms of how comfortable you'd be with it.
That's interesting, isn't it, that he decided not to put rebinding controls in there? Maybe because, again, that is what all games allow you to do, or most games. Maybe he did that on purpose.
Or couldn't be bothered.
He's
a fairly popular guy. He does a lot of stand-up commentary and stuff. he's called Alexander Bruce, the guy, I think. And I follow him on Twitter. I don't think he follows back. He's too big for that. Too big to follow the small fry indie developers. But I think he accidentally got famous from it, if you know what I mean. And it was a game jam game, or it was a small thing that he did as an experiment, and it just went crazy, and everyone loved it who played it. But yeah, I would recommend it if you like puzzles games. Go for it.
Sounds cool. I'd like to.
But I briefly mentioned Portal in there as well. Obviously, Portal has a very different tool to a lot of other games, which we've talked about many, many times.
What do you think to this whole idea that there are kind of games that come out with a new mechanic? Do you think there's legs in that? Do you think that games should be aspiring to implement new mechanics?
I think they should. Yeah,
100%. Look at the. Let's take a few AAA examples that have tried something new and succeeded. Assassin's Creed 4 with the pirate ship stuff. Nobody has done pirate ships or ships, apart from maybe Ship Simulator, has done them as good as that game. It's a lot of fun to play. It's it takes away from all of the rubbish that like Assassin's Creed or Ubisoft put in all of the games these days, which we've talked about a number of times again. But it's really good. It's really well implemented.
And isn't there a rumor that the game was basically made to be that to begin with, and then the Assassin's Creed stuff was tacked on top of it?
There's always rumors in games. In
that the happens games with a lot of games. Isn't that the same with Mario Galaxy, that it was supposed to be a new IP?
That was the same.
A new platformer, and they just made it into Mario. Because all the stuff in the game isn't Mushroom Kingdom stuff, is it? Mario is Mario, right?
I'm not 100% sure about Galaxy, but I know that Super Mario Bros. 2 was supposed to be another game called Yoshida or something like that, and it was a completely different game. And if you play that game in comparison to all of the other Super Mario Bros., you know, 2D platformers, it feels and it plays totally different to all the others, but it's also a very, very good game. You know, it's one of those that Mario, you know, hardcore Mario fans like, but like people who just go and play a quick Mario game, they're not into it because it's different. You know, you have to do very different things. You have to uproot vegetables and throw them at people instead of picking mushrooms up and stuff. You know, it's a bit different.
Yeah, I have seen it. It's different.
I really like it personally. I love that game. I never completed it though, I don't think, when I was a kid. Should have done.
Yeah, that's quite a common thing. I mean, the Assassin's Creed 4 one, I would have been. I mean, if they had done it at the right time, if it was to coincide with, like, Pirates of the Caribbean or something, or some big thing like that, they could have gone, let's just make a pirate boat game. We don't need to have assassins in it. It's in Assassin's Creed 3 as well, the boat mechanic thing. And it was the best part of that game. I was like, whoa, it feels really big and powerful when you've got your cannons blaring, and yes!
It was in Assassin's Creed 3?
Yeah.
I know there was boats in that, but did you
got a boat in Assassin's Creed 3? You could go out and have fights in it and stuff.
You did, didn't you? But it was rubbish. There wasn't much content there, was there?
It was just fighting, but it was really enjoyable to me. I really liked it. And in Assassin's Creed 4, it's like open world boat, and you can go around to islands and stuff, can't you?
I totally forgot that it was in 3, because I'd have got such a low opinion of 3 that I just forgot anything that's in it.
It was good.
There was a Pirates of the Caribbean game as well, wasn't there? But it was terrible.
It'll have been a third-person action game with Johnny Depp probably just going,
It was so bad. I remember playing it briefly, and it was one of those games that was so terrible because you'd kind of get off your boat and you'd walk into the town, but you weren't allowed to walk off the path. Like, there were grass on the sides of the path, and you could not walk off the path. It was that kind of restrictive.
Well, pirates never walk on the grass. They always follow the rules. They're known for following the rules, aren't they, pirates? Always do what you're supposed to do.
Yeah. Anyway. Usually swing over the grass with rope arrows. I just read something else that I've written down. The Thief game. They know the new Thief game. And I think, to be fair, this was in the old Thief games as well, wasn't it? The rope arrows.
Yes, it's been since Thief 2, I believe.
Yeah, I remember them being in there. I don't know if you could actually climb up them in the original.
Yeah, you could, yeah. Right. You fire it and a rope would instantly appear.
Oh, right, so it wasn't like roll down thing. But again, it's a technical limitation, isn't it, I suppose, of the time. But no, yeah, you've got in the latest Thief game, or all of the Thief games, you fire up, this rope falls down, and you can then climb up it. And it adds, to me, it adds quite an interesting element to the game. However, and I don't know, again, if this is in the old games because it's so long since I played them, you can only do it in very specific places on the new Thief.
Yeah, in the originals, you could fire it into wooden surfaces, but it could be pretty much any wooden surface. So where the game really didn't want you to use a rope arrow, it'd put like a concrete ceiling or a stone ceiling. Mm. But in the new one, it's like you say, a specific point. It's like the... you know the grapple points in Far Cry 4. You haven't played Far Cry 4, have you?
Well, yeah, it's like the ledge climbing in Far Cry 3, that kind of thing.
Yeah, but in Far Cry 4, you've actually got like a grappling hook, but you've got a hook on a very specific points, and it's like that in the new Thief game, and it's not a patch on how it used to be.
That is catering for the masses, though. That is the problem. They're dumbing games down a considerable amount. I mean, I was playing Saints Row 4 the other day. And Saints Row 4, again, has got loads of quick time events in it that are just unnecessary. Just show me a cutscene. If all I'm doing is bashing A and A moves the cutscene on and there's no other options, then don't get me involved, you know? Just get on with it. I hate that. I hate the whole hand-holding. I hate the tutorials that they throw at you and all that other stuff that's becoming commonplace in all these big games.
yeah, where you sort of, you can't do anything until you've gone through a mandatory hand-holding section, the patronising, like, yeah, first half an hour of the game, and you're like, well, it's not creating the best first impression for me, really.
I'm trying to make it organic, you know?
Yeah, I remember, I mean, back in the day, you'd get, I mean, a game that has a similar mechanic to the rope thing you're talking about is Tenchu Stealth Assassins, where you had this, like, grappling hook, and you could fire it at pretty much any surface if they had, basically had a little icon, and it would sort of glow if it could hit it, and it wouldn't if it wouldn't, and if you did it, and then you fell at a weird angle, that was your own fault. Like, it you could sort of do it at any appropriate surface, and it wasn't like a glowing thing had to be flashing for it to hook onto one exact point like it is in Far Cry 4. I mean, I do think, like, can I always decide where to try? I want to try and traverse the landscape myself without traversing it the way that you're telling me to. Like, yeah, open world games are very prevalent now, and even things like free running and traversing your environment in an open way is quite popular, but it seems to be getting more restricted as we go on, and
it
not
does,
more
yeah,
open.
And that's,
it should,
again,
be the other way around.
Exactly, it should get more open, but yeah, developers, AAA developers specifically, you're getting lazy in the fact that they kind of, they don't want to reduce the amount of work that they have to do, and putting those things in place reduces the amount of playtesting they have to do. It reduces the amount of, well, mainly the playtesting, and the fact that, like, for example, when I, in my game, as I said to you before, you can run on any surface, although I have just come across a surface that I don't want people to run on, which is literally the top of a plant collider, and it's a square. It's a square box, but I don't want people to be able to get on it. So I'm obviously, because it's a plant, you know. So I'm going to write a script that says you can't climb on this, but I'm only going to apply it to things that are, you know, are totally unnecessary. But that's the thing. It's they're reducing the amount of work they have to do in the playtesting. With open worlds, I can kind of see why they're doing it, because of the amount of testing they'd have to do. I mean, look at Assassin's Creed. Look at how buggy Assassin's Creed is, because you can pretty much free run on almost anything. And it's still the case now. I mean, I haven't played Unity, and I don't think I will, but...
Just going back to, when you talked about Thief, I'm amazed that you didn't actually point out the whole stealth mechanic in that game, and the way that the original Thief spawned the light gem stealth mechanic, which I still think is probably one of the best stealth mechanics in any game.
Can you just explain that to me? Is that basically you've got a little thing that if it's dark, you're in the dark, and if it's not, you're not? Is that what
exactly
it means?
Exactly. It's basically the same stealth mechanic that you've seen in games ever since. Very few of them deviate from the norm. It's basically an indicator which tells you if you're invisible or not.
You know, I like Sky. I like the Elder Scrolls version of that.
They hired the guy who developed this, the light gem, to do that in Oblivion.
Right.
So that's where it comes from.
It's the same principle, though, because in Oblivion, I think Skyrim as well, when you're invisible, there's a little, like, closed eye on your hood, isn't there? And then when you're visible again, it fades away. Something like that. Basically the same idea. So you always know if you're undetected or when you're detected.
And I love that. I mean, I know that there's been talk recently that it's not very realistic and there might be better ways to do it, but I think it's a brilliant way to do it. It's so simple, and it just... It gives you this kind of really nice feedback loop in that you can actively seek out the shadows, you can actively seek out the stealthy route, and have confidence in the fact that you're doing it right.
Right.
Interesting sidebar, isn't it? Like stealth mechanics and how they're implemented. Sorry, go on, Chris.
Well, I was saying, if I am stealthing around, right, in Blackpool Town Centre, right, and I'm running around and I'm in the shadows, people can still fucking see me.
They can, and that's... So you're the sort of person who would maybe have trouble with that because realistic.
I don't have trouble. I do like the... I don't like the new Thief implementation. I did like the old Thief a little bit. It was all right. I didn't really play them too much. I did play one and two, but not loads. But I didn't... I really like the Oblivion one. I really like the whole Elder Scrolls implementation of stealth. But there are other reasons for me liking it, such as how you advance and how you up, you know, how you gradually become better at stealth, and eventually you get to a point where you can just walk in front of people as long as you've got
basically
crouched.
You get
better
at stealth if you just crouch everywhere, making the game last three times as long as it should.
But that's the same applied to things like EverQuest. You'd set your character, you'd bind a key to auto-swim or auto-forward, and you'd swim into a corner for hours and you'd go and have your tea in somewhere safe where there's no mobs going to get yeah. you. And you come back and your swimming's maxed out, and then yeah. you get to your next level and then you do it again sometime when you're not having, you know, not your thing. And I understand exploiting games because, you know, I've done it myself, but I want more realism. If I'm a parkour expert, I want to be able to climb to the top of that building if I've got, you know, if there's surfaces to do it. If I'm a if I'm a stealth expert, I'd rather actually physically hide from my enemies rather than standing in a shadow that's like, you know, you've got a shadow there that ends, you're stood here, and there's an enemy stood here staring right at you. You know, that doesn't do much for me. It's like exactly what it's like in the new Thief, by the way. Exactly like that.
Is it really?
Yeah, it's.
I know that we've been slagging it off, but I think Far Cry 3 and 4 actually do their stealth mechanic quite well as well. You've got your detection meter, which is when they can see you, it goes up, and when it flashes and gets that little bing sound. But the bing's a bit much because you don't really need it, but you can sort of break eye line, and you can use, like, you know, foliage and stuff to reduce your visibility. I think that works quite organically. It feels quite natural the way you do it. You know, you have to actually properly get out of their line of sight to be unseen. You can't just hide in the shadow because the games are so brightly lit. Like, you're in a really sunny place most of the time, aren't you?
Yeah.
I kind of like that one.
Let's look at the king of stealth, Metal Gear. Look at what happens when I'm playing that with you guys. If anyone watching is not aware, we're doing a playthrough of the whole Metal Gear series at the moment, and I'm playing it, and I'm playing it intensely badly. Really badly. I mean, so embarrassing.
Intensely is such a perfect word for how badly you're playing it.
It is intense.
I'm not as bad as I'm making it. Making out up to playing computer games. You know, I'm not brilliant, don't get me wrong, but I'm not this terrible. But the stealth in that, I like the different, like, levels of stealth, and it's advanced as the games have progressed, you know, as new releases have come out. But I like the different levels. I like the caution state, the danger state, you know, the kind of searching, then they go back to the patrol routes. But I don't like the fact that it is quite realistic in terms of seeing you. If they see you, that's it. You've pretty much got a millisecond to get away, and if you don't get away in that millisecond, if you do get away, they'll look around and they're like, huh, what's going on here? Oh, it must have been a rat or something. Dishonored does it, in fact. Dishonored's got a similar kind of thing, but it doesn't have.
Must have been a rat. I love that.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's the kind of.
Must have been a 6 foot tall rat wearing a trench coat
with a skull mask.
Yeah. And a crossbow.
Yeah.
Interestingly,
I posted something the other day on Twitter, by the way, about Dishonored, and it was I can't remember the exact. I'm paraphrasing, but it was something like Corvo, man who tries to prove his innocence by murdering everybody. It's pretty much the case, isn't it? Sorry, go on.
Well, depending on how you play it.
Yeah. Well, that's I did actually chime in with I played it stealth.
Like I said, Deus Ex, which is I think you would all agree is a stealth game. Mm. Well, it can be played as a stealth game.
It's kind of it has no
overt stealth mechanic though, which is really interesting. There's no light meter. There's no overt stealth mechanic in it. There's no light meter. There's only the audible cues and what the NPCs are doing to be able to tell whether you're actually hiding or not. It does it in a very nice, very organic way.
Yeah, and that's the kind of thing that I'm trying to go for. That, and possibly like a combination of the Metal Gear, like 3, Metal Gear 4 kind of guard detection, you know, caution mode type thing. I'm not sure yet. I'm not going to make it as obvious as any of those, but it's going to be something crossed between those two.
And there's a lot of mechanics in that game as well. When you think about it, there's a lot of tools. There's a lot of things that you can do that are non-lethal. The hacking, the multi-tools, Deus Ex, and the whole series, actually.
Well, no, that's the thing, is every single little tiny puzzle, almost every single one of them anyway, can be approached in a lethal, non-lethal, and a kind of stealthy, hacky way.
Yeah, I mean, you can find someone's password on a computer, or you can hack the panel, or you can destroy the panel with a rocket, or... There's so many ways to do it.
When I played that game, though, I did it stealth. I play them quite a lot. I think I've ploughed about 200 hours into Deus Ex Human Revolution. God knows how many in Deus Ex. I just play it through over and over again because I love the games. I just love how they're set up. I love the characters, the environment. I love the beautiful. But whenever I play those games, by the time I've finished the puzzle, I could have done that puzzle anyway. I've already got all of the key codes. I've already got enough tools to hack with, you know, override the hack. I've already got enough hacking skill to hack something manually instead of using a tool, a multi-tool or whatever. I've already hacked the electronics panel or I've half hacked it, you know, ready to do it if I want. Or I could just kill everybody, you know. It's... Am I the only one that plays it like that?
I tend to do all of the above. I'll try and do things in the order where I can do them logically. Like, I'll hack everything, then I'll go back and I'll kill everyone, or I'll incapacitate everyone, then I'll go and find another way into the building anyway. Like, yeah. I try and really get the most out of every level.
Honestly, the first level in the original Deus Ex, I have been... I know it off by heart. I know where every single little vent is. There's nothing that could surprise me in that level, and it's quite a big level, really, you know? There's only a few bits that are linear, and that's going up the thing right at the end, up the statue, once you've got past the first level. Once you get up
to the top, haven't you?
Yeah, there's only that bit really that's linear. Everything else is, it's just beautiful. I still remember playing that demo. I still remember watching you play that demo and you just going, "Oh, I hated it. I hate that game. It's terrible. Shit, you can't shoot. You know, you can't shoot everyone, mate. That's the point. You can if you get really good at it, but you
I
have
understand
to be...
that now. When
yeah,
I
you
did
do.
At the time.
But yeah,
I appreciate that.
Enough stealth game spoofing, I think.
Yeah, but that is a mechanic that has been played out, and it did really start with the original Thief.
Yeah. I mean,
I'm going to add one more into it, which is a similar one to the sort of detection meter and Far Cry. But it's again, it's going back to Tenchu Stealth Assassins, which I think is a really, for its time, a really quite ambitious and underrated stealth game. And he basically, because you were a ninja, they had one. You can sort of sense the people's like chi around you, or ki. I think Japanese version's ki.
Yeah.
And basically, it was a blue number, like a little icon, and it would start at 1, and it would go up to, what, you know, 99, I think. But the closer you got to something, and then if somebody saw you, it would change to purple, and if someone was seeing you, it changed to like an exclamation mark, and it'd go orange, and that was really cool. So you knew that like. You could sort of sense where people were and what their state was without having to see them a lot of the time, and that made you feel like a bit of a ninja. You felt like you were hyper aware of your surroundings, and it was a good interface that you always knew what was going on with your enemies. So,
do you prefer then, as gamers, do you prefer the game to give you feedback and tell you if you're in stealth mode or you're hidden, or would you prefer to? Like Lou said about Deus Ex, where you organically hide and then. You know, if you're seen, you're seen at the end of the day.
I like them both. I mean, when I first mentioned stealth mechanics, I did talk about the thief mechanic, which is where you are told specifically when you're hiding and when you're not, and then all the gradations in between when you might be visible. But yet, I'd really appreciate Deus Ex not putting any stealth meter in there and basically leaving it to you to work out. Both have the merits. Does Splinter Cell have a stealth?
It has the same shadowy thing, which for Splinter Cell is completely stupid because you've got glowing lights on your front and
yes,
back.
Yes, you do. I always
his goggles are always glowing, and he's got like a battery pack on his back that's always glowing. So it's like, right, wherever I am, I've got a green light on me. Like, they can see me. Of course they can. You had that same thing, Chris, you were talking about, where the guy, if he stood next to you, can't see you. It's like, can he not see this green light that's shining in his face? Because I'm in a shadow.
I found Splinter Cell, because I'm a Metal Gear fan again, I found Splinter Cell to be a bit of a... I don't know, it just felt a bit cheap, I think. That's the only way I can really describe it.
You liked it.
Interesting.
I wish I'd liked it.
It was my gateway drug into stealth, though, so I've got to like it.
I liked the fact that you could, like... Was it doing the splits or something on a what, and you could hide yourself? I like that kind of cool stuff, but I don't know, the game itself just lacked a little bit. Maybe it was a bit too serious for me or something.
It was pretty brutally difficult as well, from what I remember. It was really unforgiving. If you basically got detected... I know you could say a little bit to say Metal Gear, you would always get overpowered, but you could run away, whereas in that, it felt like it was really hard once you got detected to bring it back.
A lot of it was in quite enclosed environments as well, wasn't it? Like corridors, and you'd...
Well, yeah,
you There wasn't really multiple ways to do things either. You're on a linear path with
stealth. It was kind of linear, yeah. But when you talk about enclosed, yeah, one of the levels you have to infiltrate the FBI headquarters.
Mm.
And it's like you're walking around offices full of people and kind of hiding in the corridors. It's really tense and very cool. I like the fact that it's possible to do that. It made you feel like you really were infiltrating somewhere that you shouldn't be.
Well, this is all making me think of Hitman again after playing it recently, or playing Absolution recently, and the amount of different mechanics in there. There's so many different things that you can do, but there's also you're kind of hiding in plain sight most of the time, but you're a kind of famous assassin, but you know, and you've got this barcode. Well, actually in Absolution you don't have the barcode on the back of your head, but
he's finally got it covered up, has he?
Well, you find out if you play it ever.
Alright, okay. I kind of want to, because I like the other games in the series.
Do you have tools in that game then? Because what I'm thinking with Sam, one of the things that I didn't really think about, but I just have, is in Splinter Cell, you have things like the underdoor camera.
Yeah. That's come from other games, though. I mean,
isn't that in Deus Ex Human Revolution?
Yeah, I think it is. It's also in Rainbow Six as well.
I'm thinking of Rainbow Six, sorry.
Tom Clancy games all have it, I think. I think he's got a bit of a hard-on for cameras.
Most of that's based on kind of like a little bit on reality, at least, isn't it? It's not fantastical.
Those cameras are real, aren't they?
Yeah. They're endoscope.
You know, there's a gun that shoots around corners.
Yeah, yeah. It's like the all the magazine is on the front of the gun and it bends round. It's got a little camera on it and everything.
Weird, but yeah.
What a wuss.
That's weird.
Yeah, just stand in front of the bullets.
Just get a pistol.
Yeah, get a Desert Eagle.
Pull it sideways as well.
Yeah.
Bam.
Speaking of thief again, there's a few tools in that I wanted to mention, not just the rope arrows, but there's also the things like the water arrows. Someone else mentioned that. But yeah, you can, you know, you extinguish flames. I like that kind of thing. But again, that's playing on the light and dark mechanics. The other one was in the latest Thief, and I don't think this is in the old ones. You've got a screwdriver, but you can buy it at a certain point when you get enough credits, and you use it to open grates up. So instead of actually getting, you know, just opening a grate and going in it like you would in, maybe, I don't know, Batman, that's another one. Batman's got full of gadgets, isn't it? And you use the grappling hook on grates to pull it out.
You can do, yeah.
Ones that are elevated, anyway.
The ones that you can't reach, yeah, you have to do that. That's got some great gadgets, those games.
It's got some, yeah, it's probably...
Does it have bat anti-shark spray in it?
You do, actually, you do fight a shark in Arkham City, but you don't have any bat spray to fight it in.
Chris doesn't know what I'm about.
It is mint though, because it's so stupid but so great, because you're in like just to go off topic for a bit, you're in the penguin's like stronghold, and it's all frozen, so he's got a shark in a pool that's frozen, so it's like, well, sharks don't swim in that sort of cold water. It's a great white shark, and it comes out onto the ice and like it'll be like onto the ice, a bit like at the end of Jaws where it clamps onto the boat. It'll do that on your little ice float thing, and you punch it in the nose. You have to do like a combo, like beat and like to make it let go. So you're basically punching a shark to death as Batman.
Nice. That doesn't get any better than that, does it?
It's like great but shit at the same time.
Chris, anyway. After the stream, Google bat anti shark spray. And you won't be disappointed.
Bat and tell
it's
me,
from
remind
the
me
Adam
about
West
it.
Batman film.
It is, yeah.
Oh God! Oh no! I think I might remember. That might have just.
He's hanging from a helicopter, and there's a shark on his leg. So he sprays it with bat anti-shark spray, and it drops off.
And he just so happens to have some on him.
Just happens to have it in his utility belt.
That's also the bit where he's running around with the bomb, and he's like, "There are some days you just can't get rid of a bomb."
Bombs, talking about bombs.
I also mentioned Assassin's Creed again. With they don't have that many gadgets. You think there's more in Assassin's Creed than there is, but they introduced that bomb making mechanic at one point, didn't they?
Which was really tedious.
But I really wanted to get them all for some reason. I really wanted to get them all, but yeah, I didn't use them. I just wanted to make them.
Yeah, there was like a standard smoke bomb which you had in like the earlier games,
which was brilliant like when they first introduced it. The smoke bomb was like that's a really cool introduction.
I thought that's the one you meant when you put the bombs in. I was like the smoke bombs that are like just make you absolutely nails because you could just stab everybody when they're not looking.
Mm.
And then you had like was there like a sticky bomb that like attached something?
There was loads. There wasn't just a couple. There was loads of them. And yeah, it was just a superfluous. I mean, they removed it in the next game, thankfully. But wasn't that in 3 as well?
No, it was in Revelations. I think.
Revelations. I think that was a fairly good game, apart from the bomb making.
It was all right. I was getting a bit tired of just the same old Ezio shit by that point. It was like the third game with Ezio going around, and I was just a bit like, ugh.
Yeah,
it's all right.
They dug his grave, didn't they? Unfortunately, towards the end.
It's a shame because he is still one of my favourite video game characters, but they knew that he was a good character and really over-capitalised on that. Like they went too far with him. They should have just let him go after 2 games and been like, keep him cool, let him go, and he's gone. And it's like, you can remember the good times, whereas now I'm a bit like, oh, they kind of like stretched him out too much.
Yeah.
His story was over and they kept adding more shit into his story that didn't really make sense. Anyway.
Yeah,
not a mechanic.
But I mean, speaking of Assassin's Creed, the mechanics, I've had a whinge about this before in general. The mechanics in Assassin's Creed are just repeated over and over and over again in every single Ubisoft game, as we've said. I mean, they were cool in the first one. They were all cool ideas, but they weren't implemented enough. In the second one, it kind of came in and like climbing towers and stuff, and there was some interesting buildings to climb, and you know, you had. You had quite a few more like tasks to do, but they all got a bit repetitive. And then there was 2, Brotherhood and then Revelations. Is that the order?
Yeah.
Brotherhood, I think, was probably my favourite. I think out of them all, they'd got it right by then. They'd got the mechanics right, and they'd got the balance of things to do as well right. But
the combat was really good in that one as well, I remember.
Yeah. It was more interesting. Instead of just button bashing, you had holding away from the enemy and swapping between enemies and stuff and parrying and that. But you could also steal weapons as well. You could take weapons off people, couldn't you, in that one?
Yeah.
Couldn't do that before that, I don't think.
I don't think so. That was really cool. I like doing that, actually.
I remember following it quite closely, and now I'm just like, whatever. You can release another 6, and I don't think I'll play any of them. They're just the same game now, you know? I'm amazed people are still buying them, I've got to be honest. It's got to be people buying, like, the first Assassin's Creed game that they've ever bought.
I don't know, maybe it is. It's like every time someone turns 13, they just buy the newest one that's out, rather than going back and buying the older one. Because it's the same with like your other churned out. I mean, sports games have been playing this trick for fucking decades now. You know, FIFA 15, FIFA whatever. It's like, it's the same. You're paying £40 for the same thing every year. It's basically a football match. They basically got it right in the PlayStation 1 era. I'm sure that's not true. I'm sure there's more advanced like moves you can do in it
now.
Pro Evo,
isn't it? And the Pro Evo was like said to be the best football game.
Serious Soccer was the best football game ever.
Is that on the Mega Drive?
No, earlier than
Amiga.
That. Yeah.
It's just sports games in general. EA Sports in particular have been playing that shit. Like, when you think about how many sports games they've got going on in their American ones, they've got the NBA, they've got the NFL, the hockey, like every single sport that they've got, they would do a yearly release game for it every year. I mean, it's just a license to print money, pretty much.
It is. Yeah.
I mean, it's like, but then again, the people that are buying them, I'm not saying sports games are terrible, because I mean, some of them are really good. I bought the first UFC game that they brought out, or the first decent one. I mean, I think there was one that was brought out on like the Mega Drive, not Mega Drive,
like the PlayStation 1 or something.
Yeah, it was just getting started. Yeah, it wasn't great at all. It's something like maybe PlayStation 2. I think they had a few more polys than the PlayStation 1, but yeah, it was. It apparently really badly implemented, but the one that me and you played, UFC 2010, I think it might have been, or maybe earlier than that.
2009, I think, was the first one.
Yeah, whatever it was, anyway. Really loved it. Really, I thought the commentators were really good on it. I thought that the moves were interesting. It was quite fluid. There was a few moments where you'd be, right, is it actually responding to what I'm doing, or is it? Yeah, but the 40 games, they're just apparently they get better every time, and they just have new licenses, don't they? People have changed teams, and now they've got what they could do is release a really good football game and then connect it to online properly. I mean, I don't know if they'd do this. Yeah, and update it so you wouldn't have to buy it. But you know what? That wouldn't make them as much money, so that's why they don't do it.
Yeah, exactly.
It's simple as that.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure that they do. I'm not saying that they don't make a new game each year. I'm sure that every couple of years there probably is like a cool advancement. So every like two FIFA games might be worth getting, but not every single one. Maybe, I don't know, like if you're really into that kind of gameplay. But I just can't see it myself. I mean,
I think we're a bit biased as well, because I don't think any of us play sports games, do we?
And we don't like football either, do we?
Or like football. Well, I think Sam tolerates it.
You two are intolerant of it.
I'm totally intolerant.
I used to
be really
intolerant of it.
I used to watch it when I was a bit younger, just because other boys did, sort of thing. And then I gradually just sort of went, like, I actually don't really enjoy this very much, and then stopped. I used to enjoy playing a few footy games, but then I would enjoy any game that's good and you can be competitive with. Like, I used to really enjoy fighting games as well, when you could play it with your mates and play against them. So I kind of I just enjoyed that kind of competitive game anyway.
I played footy when I was a kid, and I played it like rugby, because I preferred rugby and I was in rugby teams and stuff.
You'd pick the ball up.
No. I'd use my feet, but my body would be rugby, basically. Everything. I'd be barging people and tackling them with my hands and stuff, and you can't do that in
shooting
football.
Shooting them with rocket launchers.
What is that, rugby? Does that happen in rugby?
That's you playing rugby.
Gentleman's game for thugs with rocket launchers.
This is like future rugby, when we're in like a dystopian future where it's like blood sports are on telly.
Blood Bowl or whatever.
Yeah. Blood Bowl, that's good. That is a good game to play.
See, I've often thought that, like, again, just to go off on a tangent, I've often thought that Big Brother and stuff like that would be so much more interesting if it was like a last man alive.
Have
like,
you contest, seen? Oh, you, I think you have seen Dead Set, haven't you, Sam?
Yeah. It's class.
Dead Set is Charlie Brooker's zombie version of Big Brother, Lou. Nice. And it's actually quite good. It's Charlie Brooker, so it's. Mm. I mean, I'm a big fan of the guy, but.
It's a genuinely good addition to the whole sort of zombie genre as well. I'd say if you think of it as a movie in two parts, or it's like three episodes and then like an hour episode at the end, isn't it?
It's definitely like worth watching. Definitely worth a go if you're even remotely into zombie stuff, or even if you're not. Okay. To be fair, I think it's got quite a lot of social commentary in it as well, as again you would expect from Charlie Brooker.
And zombie films, that's what zombie films are supposed to be
about.
Yeah,
well, some zombie films.
The good ones, not like zombie strippers or whatever.
Or the remake of Dawn of the Dead, which is not even slightly satirical. Or not satirical, that's the wrong word.
It's got a little bit of that in there, but it's more of a straight-up like horror film.
Whereas the first Dawn of the Dead is pretty much all about that, isn't it?
I really like the remake of Dawn of the Dead. I'm just
really
totally not even on the topic anymore, but I do like the remake of Dawn of the Dead.
let's get it back on topic with a zombie game that I thought introduced a very nice mechanic, which was Left 4 Dead. Left 4 Dead's director mechanic I thought was excellent.
What's that then?
Which one's this?
Left 4 Dead.
No, I know what Left 4 Dead is. I mean,
right, the mechanic was that basically the game had an AI that wasn't directly controlling the zombies. It was basically choosing when to throw the zombies at you. And it would try and create some contrast in the game. So it would like, it would throw a massive horde at you, then give you a bit of like leeway, and quieten things down, and then throw some more at you. And it was really clever in the way that it kind of created this kind of peaks and troughs gameplay. And that was the whole selling point of Left 4 Dead. Really, was the idea that you had this kind of almost procedural, intelligent, godlike AI directing the game.
I was going to say, is that technically procedural gameplay?
It is, in that sense
that it's giving you the enemies when it sort of decides to.
When I play that game, it didn't feel like... It does feel like the zombies come at you at different times, but it didn't feel like... I didn't feel like I was under pressure. I just knew at some point another horde would be coming.
Well, I played a hell of a lot of it in co-op.
So have I. I've played a fair amount. Not as much as you, obviously, but...
Yeah, I put many, many hours into that in Left 4 Dead 2, and I felt... It was beautifully orchestrated. It felt like there was someone in the computer basically having a go at you, like playing with you. Like he'd ease off for a bit and lull you into a false sense of security, then throw everything he's got at you, and then a tank would come around the corner and beat the shit out of you. I remember laughing at how kind of malevolent it felt.
Chaotic.
Yeah, well, not even chaotic. It felt like it was purposely trolling you. It was great.
I just felt like that. I was shooting loads of zombies to me. It just felt like it was just a never-ending same thing over and over and over and over.
I really enjoyed it, and it did feel really nice, and it was a touted mechanic. It wasn't just a case of when you walk around the corner at this point, a lot of zombies would fly in.
I did appreciate that part of it. In fact, I enjoy playing it with you guys again, but I don't like playing it for hours, you know? That's the problem I have with those games. I get a bit bored of them, and I want to move on to something a little bit more cerebral or different, you know, a totally different mechanic again. Speaking of something completely different, you know, like, for example, moving from an FPS game to moving to a strategy game, you know, something like Civ or something like that. Civ's mechanics are interesting.
Civ has a lot of mechanics as well, doesn't it? It's like every one of them has many more.
And every single game is different as well, isn't it?
Mm.
I was actually looking at a board game of Civilization yesterday, because I was looking at getting Risk. We've recently played a few board games, like with some friends and that. We've got some anyway, but yeah, it was the other night we were playing Monopoly. It's not exactly a strategy game, but there is a bit of strategy to it. And for once, first time in my life, I trounced everybody. Like, I don't know how I did it, because I started off first. I know I'm going off topic, but shut up. First round, I got in jail, and I was in jail for 4 turns. People had been around the board 3 times before I got out of jail. Then I had to go around the board before I could actually buy any properties, and I ended up with all of the properties, and I don't know how I managed it. I was just lucky, I think. And that's
they
a
let
problem.
You win.
No, they didn't. They didn't. Believe me.
Where was my invite? Because I haven't played Monopoly in probably 15 years.
Hey, mate, you are welcome to come round whenever you want. You honestly, more than welcome. More than welcome. It was kind of an impromptu. A friend came round and he suggested it, because we played it last time he came round. So, but yeah, the point was, Civilization board game, apparently you need a humongous table for it. I can't imagine how it would work.
World atlas like table.
Again, all the mechanics, every unit's got a different mechanic, loads of different strategy games all cover many different mechanics.
Yeah. I don't think I'd like playing Civ as a board game. I think I like board games on computers, because you don't have to do all the board shit. You have to roll the dice and things like that.
See, I suggested getting Risk on the computer and playing it with Sal downstairs, and she's a bit funny about Risk anyway, because she's like, it's a big long game and I'm going to get bored of it. I imagine I would. And it's like, I remember both me and the other guy that was here playing Monopoly with us, we both said, I remember Risk, I remember absolutely loving it, can't remember anything about it.
It's a simple game, though, from what I remember. It's the kind of game where if you sat down and started playing it, it'd come back to you. Like, I remember it being a good, like, easy to pick up, fun to play game for anybody.
Like computer games, they've actually released a vast number of versions of Risk as well. There's a Star Wars Risk, there's tie-ins, there's a Walking Dead Risk, and there's all kinds of other ones. But the main Risk release has been updated a number of times since the original, so the game that you know will be different now, slightly. They've introduced extra cards, and I don't know, I can't really remember anything about it. I just remember I really loved it when I played it.
You can't now go into Rimmer's Risk speech.
I don't know what you mean, but what's you have to do you know it?
I can't
Is that the episode
you don't know me very well
planet?
Yes, Lou, there's no way that I retain any kind of quotes or information from TV shows, as much as I love them. I'm incapable of doing that. It just doesn't sit.
There's a very famous opening part of
Both episodes. So Mythalo in chat has just said Civ originated as a board game, and a lot of guys at Firaxis made board games on the side. That's interesting. That's cool.
It makes sense as well for that kind of thing. Now, was Civilization the first, you know, top-down strategy game? What was the first one? Because I think of Command & Conquer. Is that before Civilization?
I think there was one before Command & Conquer.
It's a different type of game, no, isn't it? That's real-time strategy as opposed to strategy.
Yeah, turn-based strategy or 4X strategy.
They're not a million miles away from each other. You have a top-down view. You build stuff and fight other people like from the top-down view, and you have to use your resources.
They're still strategy games.
They're not a million miles apart from each other.
There are a number of different types of strategy games on PC. That said, you could even class MOBAs as strategy games, really, couldn't you? To an extent. They don't build anything, but...
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, it's actually a stretch to call most RTSs strategy games. They're more real-time tactics.
Go on, you don't have to stop because I'm doing.
Well,
something.
I was expecting a response to that, but then.
Can you illuminate the specific difference between tactics and strategy?
Tactics is small scale. Tactics is about fighting individual battles, whereas strategy is about directing the war.
Dune 2 is apparently one of the earliest.
Dune 2 is one of the first RTS games, if not the first RTS game, yeah.
In Television's Utopia by Don Daglow in 1982 to be an early real-time strategy game.
Don Daglow? That's a porn star name, isn't
it? That's a porn name, isn't it? Very close to Dirk Diggler, that, isn't it?
It is. Don Daglow.
Yeah, I mean, I've liked strategy games, but I've never been like a... I'm an FPS guy, you know. I've never been a true strategy fan, I think. Mainly because of the amount of time that they take to play, usually.
And the learning curve, usually, as well.
I started playing, for some reason, I wanted to test out my GeForce Experience install. I just upgraded it. And you can, you know, with the game optimizer or whatever it is, you can set it so it. And I picked up Warcraft 3 on my computer, and I haven't played that for years. So I ran it, and I got it working in 1080p, and it looked awesome. It was amazing because the max resolution you can put it in the game is something like 1024x768 or something like that. And I got it working in 1080p and played an entire game. I played two games because the first game, I forgot what I was doing. No idea. So I started just kind of running my troops around. They got killed almost instantly the first time I went to see anybody or saw anyone. And I forgot to build any base stuff, so they just trounced my base and completely destroyed me. But then I played another game, but got a bit... I got not bored, but I got a little bit like, oh, I've played this a million times before. I'm starting to get, you know, I started to get into it now. And that's the way that strategy games kind of sit with me. As much as I can play Civ forever and a day, it's still just an addictive gameplay mechanic, isn't it? That's really all it is. You're not actually really achieving that much with them, in my eyes. It's, you can play hundreds and hundreds of turns and not really be much further on than you were 100 turns ago, you know?
Yeah. So talking about interest mechanics in sort of real-time strategy games, but Battlezone 2 hadn't... I loved the way that the mechanic was introduced in that, because Battlezone 2, if anyone hasn't played it, was ostensibly kind of a first-person shooter. But
No, it wasn't. No. The first-person part of it was absolutely terrible, but you could do it if you wanted to.
But it was played out like that, but then you'd build like your command post, and you're basically in the sky playing it like an RTS game.
I know why you think it's a first-person shooter, because you were always on my team, and I was always the commander, and
exactly.
I always did all the RTS stuff, and I was so just spent the entire game arranging
that,
everyone.
As a mechanic in itself, there have been other games recently. I think Smite does that, doesn't it? Smite
Evolve,
is kind of a hybrid.
Not Evolve.
Not Evolve.
Oh, my lord. It's the one where you can be aliens and you can be humans.
That's Natural Selection.
Natural Selection, yeah.
Yeah.
It's not very good, but it's tried to do that.
Games have tried to do it, but I don't think any have ever done it as well as Battlezone 2. Battlezone 2 was brilliant.
Yeah, and it was very, very underrated as well. That and if I ever struggle to have a top five again, and I forget about that game in my top five, it's definitely up there. Because I had so many hours of enjoyment playing that. And even though it's like, right, you're supposed to grab some choke points on the map, basically, like most strategies, you know, you make sure that you grab the resource points and everything else like that. And you go and, you know, build up your army and go and attack the base strategically. But the beautiful thing about that, my favourite things... Was it, say, for example, you were flying around in a ship and you went off to attack a base and got destroyed by a tower or whatever. I could send a unit to you, and then you could get in the unit, and you've got a big walker or something, and you can either come back to base or you can go and attack again or do whatever you wanted to do. But I could literally see the entire battlefield, talk to you on voice comms or shout over the room, because we usually played it at the LAN parties, and tell you what to do and where to go. I loved that, and I wish more people got into it. In fact, I need to get a copy of Battlezone 2. I'm going to look on Good Old Games, see if it's on there, because someone nicked mine years ago. It's amazing.
It was a fantastic game.
Looks terrible. No, actually, no, it doesn't. It still looks okay from my recollection.
It looks old.
Yeah.
You'll see when you play it, won't you, how good it looks.
Yeah. But I bet it doesn't run, actually, now on my PC either.
Talking about sort of turn-based stuff as well. The VATs in Fallout 3.
Mm.
Now, I know a lot of people who played that game and didn't use VATs at all. They played it like a first-person shooter. I used it almost exclusively.
I did.
And I really enjoyed it. I thought as a mechanic to put into what felt like a first-person shooter, it was really, really good. It changed the dynamic of the game entirely. It made it... I don't know. It completely changed the feel of the game.
So what VATS is, to those who may not be aware, don't know what it stands for specifically. Doesn't know either. It basically
Veronica's
was when you...
ass takes...
asunder.
Smacking...
it stands for video assisted thoracic surgery, apparently, but I don't think that's the right one.
No.
Vault tech assisted targeting system.
That's it. So, yeah, basically, that says what it is. When you saw an enemy, you could enable VATS. I think you pressed space or something like that, or Lewell has pressed fucking asterisk or something because he's weird and left handed. And you press space and it paused the game, and you could choose the area on the antagonist. That you'd want to antagonist. That's the wrong word, isn't it?
Enemy.
And you could choose the area, so you could choose a headshot. But you've got different percentages per, and it just gave you all of the, it was all built into your Pip-Boy, which was like a little computer you carried around, and it just allowed you to kill people quickly. I think
it paused. Yeah, it basically paused the game and give you some percentages and let you shoot up parts of the body. But it was brilliant because you'd like. You decide if like there's some super mutant coming at you. Do you go for the risky headshot, but it might kill him in one, or do you try and blow his arm off holding his weapon so he can't shoot at you? Do you shoot his legs off so it slows him down? You know, it introduces an element of strategy or tactics, I guess, into a game where you normally wouldn't have time to think about that stuff.
But wasn't Fallout the original 1 and 2, weren't they top-down strategy games?
They were, yeah. They were.
I never played them. I got them free from Good Old Games ages ago. They were doing a promotion. I downloaded them, but I haven't played them yet. Should maybe give them a go.
Bethesda developed Fallout 3, but it didn't develop the earlier ones. It was by somebody else, and I'm not sure who.
Yeah,
I can't remember either.
And it's basically
franchise.
Same engine as Oblivion as well. It's Oblivion engine.
It's Oblivion with guns in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
Have any of you played New Vegas? Because I've got it, and again, I played about an hour of it, but I just didn't get into it.
Same here. I played a couple of hours, actually. I tried it a few times because people say it's better than Fallout 3.
I've got that as well.
I couldn't get into it.
I think the reason I didn't play it is because I tanned Fallout 3 so much. Same way I did with Oblivion. And it was like New Vegas didn't look different enough for me to warrant the time investment. Whereas when Skyrim came out, I was like, whoa, new engine. I could see they'd put new game mechanics in there. I could see it was a new game. And I was like, I'm into that. Whereas New Vegas looked like a big expansion pack on that. And I was like, do you know what? I just don't have another... 50 odd hours I put into Fallout 3 to spare.
You do. It's just that you have to choose where you put that 50 hours.
I've never really thought about this, but the day that I play an Elder Scrolls game and I don't play it to death will be a very sad day indeed. Because every Elder Scrolls game I've played, I've put so many hours into it.
And you still haven't touched... I bet you still haven't skimmed the surface on them.
Well, I've covered quite a bit, but I still haven't completely 100%ed any of them, but... I still don't hold them in massively high regard, and I don't know why.
You don't?
No, I don't. Well, really? I wouldn't put them in my top 10.
Skyrim is definitely up there in my top. I mean,
Skyrim's
Oblivion.
A brilliant game.
I'd probably say Oblivion's better, but I think Skyrim, I don't know, just there was more.
Skyrim was the best.
There was more world to interesting world there, you know.
It felt more like each dungeon that you went into, each cave had its own little thing going on that made it.
Well, it
unique.
Did. They actually
they weren't just cut and copy and paste.
Instead of using like prefabs and kits for the caves like they did in Oblivion and Morrowind, and they were all basically the same one, twisted around or upside down or something. They put time into creating kits that made it modular and easy to put together, but they could make it each cave unique, even though there was repeated prefabs and repeated areas and textures. It wasn't as obvious because they could make a more interesting world, and they did that with everything in Skyrim. There's towns, there's cities. They had hundreds of people working on it, though. You know, teams.
It was really noticeable, though. It really elevated that game. It felt like the fact that the wait from Oblivion to Skyrim was so long, you were like, yeah, it was worth the wait. It was like they spent a few years making what was really good. They changed a few of the skills and changed a few mechanics, which I wasn't that keen on because they seemed to restrict you. In particular, they took away acrobatics.
What have you two fapping? I can hear a fapping noise. Only when Sam was talking then, though. Just, go on, sorry.
No, just my mouth flapping. Yeah, they sort of changed the acrobatics thing because there were certain areas in the game they didn't want you to sort of like be able to jump into when you weren't supposed to, whereas that was one of the great things about Oblivion was jumping on roofs and being like a sort of crap ninja who would just jump on people's roofs and be an idiot, whereas you couldn't do that in this game, and I missed that, but most of the other mechanics that they implemented or changed felt more polished and that, and for that, a game of that size, it felt, despite all the bugs it had in it, it felt really quite polished and well put together.
I didn't experience that many bugs in either. I mean, I know there was PlayStation bugs, you know, when it launched on PlayStation, it was just unplayable.
It was lag. It was lag.
But I didn't experience that many problems with Skyrim. I mean, apart from the interface, the user interface needed an overhaul for PC, but they didn't give it to us.
Take a horse up a hill and you'll experience some... That's not really a bug, but some dodgy... I don't know what you call that, physics programming.
Yeah, if you take a horse uphill, then you get to see the horse come down the hill upside down on fire.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Now, one mechanic I want to talk about, and this is, it's not in a particular game, although we can go into games, is time. I've noticed that a few of the things I've been wanting to talk about when thinking about is the way that time is used in games, how you manipulate time, or you have to deal with it as a factor, like the, you know, the time reversal in Prince of Persia, or the Ocarina of Time where you go to the future. There's loads of time and Braid. I've not played it, but I want to, because it's all about time travel and time manipulation. And I think it's an interesting thing that games allow you to do, is to manipulate time.
And some do it in quite subtle ways, like the stuff in Dishonored where you can slow time down and then beat the shit out of people and stuff.
Yeah, some quite really a lot of nice.
Yeah, I quite like that sort of stuff. Even though I don't really use it, I always feel like it's quite cheap to use that. Like, there should be better ways to do it than basically do the call Matrix on someone's ass.
Well, you know when we first started looking at Subnet, Lou, and we talked about how we were going to use time in that, I still want to do something like that, which was basically, and I don't know if there's any other games. If there is, please let us know, anybody who's listening. I wanted to take like a proper day night cycle, but I wanted to make missions time dependent. So, for example, you'd walk around a city, and you'd maybe want to go into a particular building or something. You want to go into it and hack a load of devices, but you'd only be able to do that at certain times, and all of the NPCs would be on shifts. And there's games like Skyrim where they've got people running around and doing things and going home and then going to work and then going to the pub and then coming home. That all takes time, unfortunately, and effort and scripting and, you know, quite a lot of work. But I like that. I really like... Again, it goes back to realism. The more realistic you can make a world, instead of having a guard that just walks up and down and up and down for hours and hours and hours, you know? It's like... I don't know. I know it's a lot of effort, but I want it. I want more of that in games.
Daggerfall had that, and it was hilarious. There was a bug... Well, not a bug, an exploit, I guess, where you could go into a shop just before closing time, and then just after closing time, the shopkeeper would disappear, he'd go to bed, then you'd nick all the stuff off his shelves, wait inside his shop until open time again, and sell all of his stolen goods back to him.
But they've obviously addressed that in the more recent ones, where if you try and sell it, they'll either say, sorry, I don't, or they'll call the guards, something like that.
Yeah, basically, you have to sell it to a fence, so you can never sell... stolen goods to but the person.
I always sold all of my stuff to the fences because it increased your reputation with them, and then you could sell better stuff to them and they'd have more money. So,
yep.
But anyway.
Yeah, the manipulation of time is an interesting one.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a game, a series that I've played quite a lot, and it was the fifth Ratchet & Clank game. Had a really cool separate mechanic, because it's called Ratchet & Clank. There's a character called Ratchet who's like a cat like type thing who has loads of guns and jumps around, and he's got a little robot buddy called Clank, and they get separated in the fifth one, and Clank goes to this like massive sort of time clock that keeps the universe running, and you have to do all these really cool time related puzzles where you have to you'll have to do record yourself doing an action and then go back to the beginning and then stand on another foot, like you do one foot pad, it'll be green, you'll go and press a switch, and then you'll go back to the blue foot pad and record again, and your other little you goes and does the switch when he's green. You have to go to somewhere else when you're blue, and you have to have like four versions of yourself running around, opening doors and switches for yourself. It was really cool. Like, it was all about manipulating time and recording yourself and then going back and using that to get through the puzzle. It's really hard to describe without having video, and I'm only just like, remembering it now.
Sounds really interesting.
It wasn't the main bulk of the game. The game would break away to those sections every like few hours. Really, really cool though. Quite unique, something I've not seen in games before as well.
It does ring bells though, that for some other game that I've played. I mean, Portal's a little bit crazy like that in terms of playing with your perception of how games should be and reality and Antichamber, again, those kind of games. I'm sure there's another game that does something similar to what you just said there, where you have to do multiple things at the same time. There's quite a few, actually.
Do you know what I'm thinking of? I'm thinking of The Lost Vikings.
Oh, yeah. Oh, God, I haven't played that for years. That was brilliant. In fact, there's a few games back then that were like that.
I must admit, I didn't like it. I don't like games where you have to control multiple characters.
King Arthur's World.
Between them.
That was another one. King Arthur's World on the SNES. That was just like The Lost Vikings. You know, you had, instead of having four Vikings or whatever you had, you could buy units, and the units you'd have to move and position, like you'd have archers that would be firing and stuff, but you'd have them firing while your knights go in and have to kind of climb up to the top of a building. It's ages since I played it, so I can't remember off the top of my head everything, but I think if I'm in the right mood, I like that kind of stuff. The puzzles at the end of the day, aren't they? They're just a different way of doing a puzzle. It's like Lemmings, you know. Lemmings is it's quite stressful at sometimes because you're trying to remember which thing you need to use in which point and trying to save the right amount of amount of lemmings before you get into the next bit.
Yeah. Out of interest, Sam, have you played Lost Vikings? Do you know anything about it?
I've never heard of it before.
Right, it was an old game. I think it came out on the Amiga or something like that. It's around that era. But basically, I think it's three or four Vikings that you control, and you switch between them, and each one has a different skill. So one of them's got a shield that you can jump on top of. One of them can run really fast. No, sorry. Yeah, one of them can run really fast and jump. One guy's got a shield, but he can't jump, but he can allow people to stand on top of him. Another one has another skill. I think he can punch stuff, like hit enemies out the way. I think that's it. There's three, isn't there?
I can't remember. I think there's four, but I can't remember them.
But basically, yeah, you've got to keep switching between them because each one can do different things in level, and you've got to get to all these levels using combinations of these three Vikings.
See, that's made me think about modern games. That, I mean, look at Thomas Was Alone. Thomas Was Alone is a very, very simple implementation of The Lost Vikings when you think about it. It's,
I've not really played it.
Thomas Was Alone is you start off as this little brick called Thomas, and it's very well narrated and well written. But you walk around and you have to basically jump, get to the next point, and then you meet someone called John, and John is a really tall block but thin, and he can only get through certain areas and only do certain things. Then you meet someone called Jane. I can't remember all the names off the top of my head, but I think Jane is she's a bouncy one. She's like, if one of your other blocks jump on her, she bounces them off them. And then there's another one that floats in water, that's a really big one that can transport people over water. And it gets more and more, you know, you get maybe five or six people by the end of it, but they can do different, you know, they'll two of them will be in one level, three of them will be in another level, and they'll meet up at some point. It's all part of the narrative, but it's just a puzzle game. But it comes from those kind of, you know, those kind of early games, I think.
Yeah, I think Battle Block Theatre's like that as well, isn't it?
I've just bought that, actually. Well, I bought it, I said, I think, a couple of episodes ago.
I've not played it, but I watched a hilarious speedrun of it on Awesome Games on Quick this year. But yeah, that looks like it's a similar sort of thing. You basically have to get two characters through the levels, and you can pick your skills, don't you? And that depends on how you do it.
Haven't played it yet. I just remember it's got lots of decent reviews. It's been well received, so I thought I'd grab it while I was a couple of quid or whatever. Chris sales Sebok. When I think about it, there's a lot of games that take that principle though. Take that principle of you control multiple different characters and you do each one of them has a certain skill. I'm not sure I buy it. I'm not sure it's not realistic, you know, it's a puzzle game. No, hang on.
It's not realistic that a Viking can't jump but another one can.
Yeah, that's my point. My point is
kind of unrealistic.
I can understand if this guy's an expert bowman and this guy, or archer, Bowman, whatever. And this guy's an expert lancer or something, you know, but that's... This still doesn't mean they couldn't do, but you know, this other one couldn't be a bowman. But it wouldn't be interesting, game. Would it? Yeah, I know.
It's meant to be an allegory sort of thing, not an allegory, but
not allegory. No,
I didn't mean. I mean,
if games were too realistic, they'd just be life, and it wouldn't there'd be no point in playing it. Just go outside. What? You know?
There's no point in playing real life. I'm just gonna go.
But there is no. The point is that you're not in your real life. That's the point. That's why people. That's why escapism exists, isn't it?
True, but you want there's a point where realism could detract from the fun, you know.
Yeah, no.
I think to a degree.
I mean, I think so. Look at what was it, Second Life or whatever it is. I mean, that looks rubbish. It's not exactly anything like real life, but people play that like it's their real life, you know? It's a crazy, crazy world.
Oh, they do with World of Warcraft as well, I guess, and
yeah,
any
I suppose.
Games where you can interact with other people.
Yeah, any persistent game, yeah. Right. We briefly mentioned Batman a while back, and I know you haven't played many of the games or any of the games, Luke.
I haven't played any of them. Touched them.
Me and Sam have played them to death because they are particularly good. I mean, the fighting mechanic is amazing in those games, and it was well-renowned when it came out. Very fluid, very... quick. I mean, if you're even remotely into Batman, it does it justice, you know. I think.
But even if you're just into like interesting sort of slightly it's kind of open worldy, but it's sort of leveled out for you in sections. But it's the asylum is pretty open, but it's also just a really good sort of action-y brawler with gadgets, sort of Metroidvania type game. If you like those kind of things, it's a little bit like that, isn't it? Really,
Metroidvania.
Well, you explore the world, and there are certain bits of it that you'll see and go, I can't get there yet. But when I come back later and I've progressed, I can get there. And it's like you get more out of the game by revisiting certain areas and using your new gadgets and skills to get to them.
That's in the essence of a Metroidvania game, really, that, isn't it?
Yeah, and there's a lot of fighting in it.
I consider them 2D most Metroidvania, I would imagine, but no, I suppose I could see where you're coming from.
So even if you're not into Batman, it's still just a really, really well-made third-person action game as well.
I think it's a third-person beat-em-up part of it that I'm not so sure about.
Don't be unsure about it. That's the brilliant part. If you see Arkham Asylum in a sale or something for a couple of quid, get it, man, because it's more than worth it.
I'll change my name to Chris Sebok before I do that.
I'll get it for you. Gift it to you.
If you just play through the first introductory section of the game, because you sort of walk through the asylum a little bit, you get into a little fight. The first proper mechanic you get introduced to is the fighting one. And if you don't like it after the introductory sequence and you go, this game's shit, just don't play it.
That's
but
the
if
thing
you start
as well,
to think this is quite good, just keep going and you'll probably really, really enjoy it.
There's so many good parts of that game as well. It's story parts and so many good little cool gadgets and things to do. I liked it. I even played the additional modes, the Predator mode and that on it quite a bit, because I was quite chuffed with the general mechanic. Really challenging though to get good at it.
Stay properly undetected as well.
Oh,
that
well,
has stealth mechanics in as well, but with him being Batman and all.
Oh, they were brilliant though, stealth mechanics, being able to hang from gargoyles and string people up, and you could throw your batarang and cut the rope while the other people were around just to confuse them more.
You could drop one guy on another guy's head if he was going, what's going on here? Cut the rope and it'd fall on him and be like, yeah, there's you down.
Yep.
I think you'd have to do a takedown on him once because he would sort of be dazed. But it's still class. Still really fun.
Yeah. I'm going to play that game.
Of course, Batman never kills anyone in the game, surely.
No, he doesn't. He does a lot of snapping of limbs, though. A hell of a lot of snapping of limbs.
He makes up for it by powdering people's bones.
Yeah, but to be fair, he's always done that in the comics as well. He does a lot. He's very, very... Because he's such a good martial artist, he's very, very good at just breaking people without killing them. He'll happily put someone in traction as long as they're not dead. So it's a bit of a... He's quite brutal, but he won't kill you.
Yeah, I'm not sure where that lands morally, though, does it?
It cripples you for life or kills you.
Well, no, it doesn't kill you, that's the thing.
Yeah, but that's the choices you've got, really.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not sure which one I prefer, I'll be honest.
I don't think he's ever even crippled anybody. It'll be stuff that you could recover from, but it's not nice.
He's been crippled himself.
Not nice.
He's been crippled himself and come back, and he's also died and come back like every comic book character has now.
Has he come back again now?
Yeah, he died a few years ago and came back somehow. I've not actually been following the comics properly for quite a long time, but I know that he did die and has come back. Peter Parker died. I'm not sure if he's come back yet, but he will.
I've never heard some of that woman now that everyone was annoyed about, Spider-Woman or whatever, or Spider-Girl.
I don't know. I've followed Spider-Man properly for a long time either.
You're a rubbish comic book fan, Sam.
I just like certain stories when they're done well. I don't like read them all the time. You know?
Fair enough. We're allowed to be... there's that much of it out there now. We're allowed to be selective, I think.
Exactly.
Someone mentioned Heavy Rain and Avi.
Yeah, I thought that was quite a weird sort of thing. It was basically, because I'm sure Lou's not played it. Have you seen Heavy Rain? Do you sort of know about it?
Jason!
You control multiple characters in it, and there's one of them's an FBI.
Not in the same way that you're thinking. Well, your little brow furrowed then, as you said, multiple characters.
It switches between them at certain story points. It's a very story-driven game.
Very.
It's different people are trying to find this kidnapper/murderer. One of them's an FBI agent, and he's got this sort of virtual reality glasses thing that you can put on. And when you're in the normal world, when you're looking for clues and stuff, it'll sort of highlight little things, and you can find a blood trail and follow it. And he can sort of analyse things and analyse, you know, fingerprints, those kind of stuff. And then there'll be other bits where you're back at the bureau and you'll sit down in a chair, and then Avi will create this whole weird world around you, and you can go through all your evidence like a bit like Tony Stark's computer in Iron Man, where he's just like moving it with his hands and stuff.
Isn't the world that it creates just completely superfluous? It's just to relax you and let you concentrate.
Yeah, you can pick different themes for it. You can pick like a mountaintop one and a desert one.
You just sat on this desk in the middle of the Grand Canyon or something. It's really weird.
but it was just a cool little bit of kit. And it had an interesting thing tied to it as well, was that using the Avi was actually bad for your character. And you had to take these drugs to get over there. And if you stayed in... There was one bit towards the end of the game where if you either have a choice of staying in the Avi and finding out who the killer is, or you quit and you don't find out who the killer is and get a worse ending, or you stay in Avi too long and die. Like, if you stay in that Avi too long, it just fries your brain, and you have it starts to get a nosebleed and stuff, and you're like, oh god, find the evidence.
I quite liked it. In fact, I really enjoyed that game, actually. But it's not. Do you know who the killer is, Lou? Because there's no point in playing it, really, I think, if you know.
No, I'm not
I don't know anything
that,
about it.
All right, okay.
Is it PC?
It's PlayStation.
It's PlayStation exclusive. Yeah, so
you need to get a PlayStation. Get a PlayStation 3 for next to nothing. Get it one in a sale.
Get a sale. They don't make them anymore, Chris.
Do they not? Yes, they do.
I'm pretty sure they do.
They're still
new.
Yeah.
They're still releasing games on it and stuff. All your big franchises still released on that as well. Like any COD will be released on the PSP.
They don't stop producing the previous console as soon as a new console comes out. It's not like upgrading your PC and then you never use that hardware ever again, like we do. We just put it in a corner and it just sits there and gathers dust. No, people stay on the PS3, for example. They'll stay on that for years because they can't afford to get a PS4 yet. Most of the time, you know, that's the case, but sometimes it's just there's not enough games out yet. When PS4 starts taking grip, then they'll stop. Like, I think it's a couple of years or something, then they'll stop producing the PS3. Developers will stop releasing PS3 games. That's, you know, when there's no need for it there. And I think they're in a better position now as well with all the recent consoles, because they can tell who's the numbers of people who's still using the PS3s and PS4s and Xbox 360s because they're online.
Yeah, that's true. They've got a little bit of a better gauge of how many people are still using it.
I mean, look, Sam's a PlayStation kid, you know. He's always had a PlayStation, and you took you a good while, didn't it, to get a PS4?
Yeah. How long? When was it released?
Last year, sometime.
Yeah. So it's over a year since it came out that I got one, or about a year later.
But I remember your PS3. You didn't get one of them for a while. I remember you were playing on your PS2 for a long time.
I
was still getting games. In fact, I think people only recently stopped releasing games on PS2. Maybe?
What? Surely not.
Last few years?
I don't know. I'd be surprised if that was the case. I don't know.
I might be talking at me bum then. But anyway, yes.
Just consoles' cycle is different to PC, isn't it?
Yeah, well, they don't really have cycles on PCs. It's up to you when you're ready to upgrade. The thing is, we can turn settings right down if we really want to play a game. We can just turn the settings off, you know, and not have anti-aliasing. And
I'd rather not do that.
No, no, same here, because we're PC geeks, so you know, we love if it's not on maximum settings, I'm not playing it. And if it's not maximum settings and it's not stable and my PC isn't overheating, then I'm not playing it.
Backsaw GTFO.
We're really sticking it to the man, aren't we, Chris?
Fucking right. Yeah.
Take that, somebody.
Yeah, take that, manufacturers. By the way, here's a bit of a forewarning for anybody. I believe it is my motherboard, so I'm going to call out AS Rock motherboards right now. Don't bother with them. Get an Asus motherboard or even a Gigabyte one, even though they're not that great. But AS Rock, not sure. Not sure about it. I think I've got loads of
issues. Is that your official review there, is it?
Yeah.
You're going to get litigious, okay. Litigious action from them.
I think I think there's one guy working there. I think it's that small, you know.
Some bloke in a little sort of
it's in Thailand somewhere. Eh?
AS Rock.
Yeah, I think they started as an Asus kind of cheap manufacturer. They did the cheap Asus boards.
Korean or something.
The Taiwanese.
Taiwanese, okay.
Yeah. Anyway, and I don't know. It the board looks pretty. Don't get me wrong. You know. Which sells quite a few, but I went for the features more than anything, and I didn't want to spend like £350-400 on a new motherboard like I was initially intending. But I wish I did now. I wish I'd spent that extra £100 and went for an Asus, like a top end Asus board.
So there you go, folks. If you want to experience all these beautiful mechanics in the games that we've been talking about, don't buy AS Rock.
Yeah, I'm not saying that it's definitely the board at the moment, but I have a sneaking suspicion that the board is the culprit, because it's the first time I've bought something that isn't like, you know, a top end, what they're called, enthusiast grade kind of gamer motherboard, and I should have done.
Enough.
Anyway, went off topic quite a lot then.
He did.
Yes.
We've not been very on topic today.
No,
but
we haven't.
It really matters.
I know. Mechanics could be anything, though.
Well, that's the thing about... Because we're avoiding talking about the blatantly obvious mechanics, like shooting things, running, jumping on platforms. Like, I think we all kind of take those ones for granted now. We sort of try to highlight the ones that maybe are a bit more stand out or unique or that we remembered, rather than just, oh, in Mario, you can, like, jump on stuff. Like... It's a pretty well-established mechanic that everybody's very familiar with now.
Talking of mechanics and Mario, my lord, like, as much as I love Super Mario Galaxy, I think it was in Galaxy 2, there was a bee uniform you could get, and it was the shittest thing I've ever seen in a game in my life. You're a bee, and you can kind of fly a little bit. That's it. I think you don't get stuck in honey. That's it.
That's terrible. You don't get stuck in honey. Oh, great.
Yeah, but you know, obviously there are levels that have got lots of honey, but there are some level. Right, so as much as I love the Mario games, there are some specific Mario levels that are just insanely difficult, and the spoil the game, that makes you put the controller down. That horrible, you know. That
just like the water auto scroller.
The
water auto scrollers.
Oh God,
the
yes.
Older ones.
Oh,
you're under the water and it's auto scrolling. You've got to keep going along.
Oh, right, yeah. How does he breathe underwater? Do they ever like make a thing about that?
Doesn't he have
Mario?
He has to get bubbles.
Does he?
Yeah, I think
so. Fair enough.
I know he does that in Sonic as well, but I'm not really a Mario person.
Do you know what I did on all of the water levels that I could do it on anyway? On the original Super Mario Brothers and 2. And 3. No, I can't skip them, unfortunately. Well, if my action replay. Did it? I probably did it a few times, but anyway, yeah. Normally, what you could do on those levels is you could swim just out, like the bottom of the screen. You could just go just under the bottom of the screen, like just keep tapping air, and you could swim and hit your head off the roof, and you could just swim past the whole level and avoid all of the fucking fish. Oh God, I hate those levels.
Damn fish!
There's a few like 3D levels as well that are particularly difficult. I remember one on Super Mario Galaxy 2, and I think it was a secret level or an additional level, and it was like everything was rotating constantly around this barrel, and you had to kind of it's just impossible. Everything was just impossible to do on it. You had to time your jumps perfectly, like to the pixel, to the vertex. It was horrible. Can't explain it more than that, to be fair. I'm doing a very, very bad job of that as well.
Time to the vertex.
Yes.
Yep.
Right, so, any other mechanics you guys are favouring, or the ones that you don't like?
We've sort of talked about it a little bit. Just a mechanic that we've seen in quite a lot is just the idea of free running and sort of being able to sort of traverse your environment any way you see fit. And the only game that's done this in first person that I'm aware of is Mirror's Edge. I don't know if Brink tried to do it a bit, but apparently it was crap.
Oh, Brink's. I think the problem with Brink, I found one, I got it on a console, which is a bad idea for an FPS in general, in my eyes. But secondly, the environments were too enclosed. The parkour stuff was interesting. It was okay. But again, I didn't really enjoy the controls on the pad. But it felt like the environments were too closed down and there wasn't much of an option to get. All the maps, it was like a Team Fortress 2 type game. You know, all the maps had choke points, all the maps had arenas that you could do a bit of fighting in, and then, you know, you'd have to complete objectives. But it just didn't really sit with me. I think I played it for a couple of hours and put it down, never tried it again.
I have a theory that the reason that those games haven't really taken off is because those mechanics have already been done in games that didn't set out to do that. If you look at stuff like the jump maps in Quake and Counter-Strike, the kind of parkour sort of stuff that you could do in older games that weren't designed for it is better than the stuff that's actually been designed for it. I've played Mirror's Edge and I didn't get into it at all.
I played Mirror's Edge and got to the end of it because I wanted to... I don't know. I don't know why I've completed it, because I wasn't that into it in general.
Compare Mirror's Edge to Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2.
That's fun, though, isn't it? That's just...
It's fun, but it's also kind of skateboard parkour. You can go anywhere you want. You can grind up walls and up onto rooftops and things like that. It's like...
True.
It's so much more enjoyable because it feels like you're exploiting the environment, whereas in Mirror's Edge, it feels like the environment's there for you to play with.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? There's a different feel to it. So I think that some games have done this stuff better.
Yeah.
Without setting out to do it.
And
I think the reason it works is because those kind of mechanics are the sort of mechanics where you want to feel like you've come up with the idea yourself. It wants to feel like you're exploiting the game in some way, and you're like what you said earlier about you feeling like you've broken the game. You want that. I mean, I want that. That's something that really I love in games. And when a game hands it to you on a plate, I'm not so sure.
Have you played my game? Have I given you access to it? Or
yeah, I had to go out of the LAN.
Did you?
Yeah.
You couldn't rebind the controls or anything, though, could you?
No, but I still played it and I quite enjoyed it.
See, what I'm trying to do with my game is I'm trying to make it more arcadey and more fun, but still grounded in realism, if you know what I mean. So you can't. When you do a wall run, you can't actually wall run that far, but you can wall run farther than you can jump, if that makes sense. You're jumping, again, you're not jumping miles, you're jumping just enough, you know, to kind of get over the gaps and things. And there's parts where you can jump and then kind of, you know, scuffle up the ledges and things like that. And the difference when I played Mirror's Edge felt... It felt like I was being restricted by the mechanics. The main thing being the running. When you run, it builds up velocity and it builds up momentum in Mirror's Edge. And although that can be really good if you get really good at the game, with a control pad I couldn't do it anyway. But if I played it on a PC, it might be different. I might get quite good and get used to that. But if you hit something, you lost your flow. And then it was like, I've got to build it all up again, and if I hit something just wrong, like I jump over a fence and I clip my feet on it, or I hit the top of the ledge without the right momentum or something like that, then it stops you and it takes that kind of game feeling away from you. I think
Mirror's Edge feels like a puzzle game to me. It feels like a puzzle game where they've laid out a puzzle in the form of a course, and you've got to figure it out.
There was also that. It's also quite disorientating. It's like I can't really, unless I turn on the, you know, the red markers everywhere, you can't really tell where you're supposed to go.
But when you do find out where you're supposed to go, it's kind of, that's really the only way you could have gone.
Yeah. Yeah, no, you're right. Yeah, it doesn't come across that way when you're playing it. It looks like it's actually quite open world and there's a lot of options, but it is. It's just very, very linear and from one to the other. They've actually delayed the more recent Mirror's Edge. Oh, no, they haven't delayed it. They haven't announced a date for it. I think it was last year or the year before at GDC they announced Mirror's Edge 2 and showed a quick demo. But I don't know what's taken them so long. Maybe they're making it more interesting. Maybe. Or maybe they're screwing it up by making it more restrictive. Don't know.
I'm going to be quite negative, Ian, so probably the latter. It feels like the bigger the budget, the more expectation, the more likely it is the game developers just become frustrated movie makers and want to make just something which looks cool and doesn't play that cool. Maybe.
I don't know. I did complete Mirror's Edge, and I don't know why I kept going with it, because it was different, I think, and I just wanted to play a different game, maybe. But I don't know if it is out on PC or not.
It is. Yeah, I played on PC.
Yeah,
sure, it's on PC.
It might be a lot more enjoyable on PC for me.
It's not. Well, I can't say if it's not for you, but I didn't enjoy it.
I mean, you'd hate it on console if you hate it on PC, for God's sake.
I love jumping around on jump maps in Quake 2 and stuff like that. I absolutely adore that, but this didn't do anything for me.
How long will it take you to break my game when I give you a build of it?
Considering that's
5 minutes,
pretty much what I do, I think I'll break it pretty quickly. Yeah.
What would we consider a breakage? Because something
when I'm going through walls, exiting the level somewhere. When you have to start putting invisible walls and invisible ceilings on the game, that's when you know it's broken.
Yeah, yeah. Unless Unity's collision is bad, which I don't know at this stage. I think I'm safe for that. I've done so much playtesting on it that, and I'm not just testing things that, you know, I'm trying. Mind you, I might just be testing things that I think aren't going to be broken. And that's what's interesting about. I'm going to get you to beta test it, by the way, most definitely, because I think you'll actually give me some feedback as well, which would be valuable.
Which is nice from someone testing your game.
Well, no. You'd be surprised how many developers are constantly complaining about people who beta test a game and never give them any feedback and just run off with the key or whatever.
Not really testing the game, are they?
No, they're not. They're just trying it out and getting an early key or
whatever.
Free
demo.
Yeah. But I'm going to do a closed beta, I think. The more I think about it, the more I think it's better if I do a closed beta and give it to a select few people, and hopefully they'll be honest with me about how shit it is.
I'll be honest with you.
Yeah, and I want you to be honest. Anyway, right. We've had a few people say things in chat. Let's see. Someone talking about Oblivion, which we were talking about before. Prince of Persia, the original. Don't know what that relates to.
Is this the original? Can I just
the original,
clarify?
Yeah.
As in the 2D Sam Coupe version?
I think Corpse is an old fogey. I don't know. I have the impression that he's around our age.
I'm glad you added that.
I've only played Mirror's Edge while on a treadmill, gave a great sense of achievement to advancement. That makes no sense. I'm not sure what he's talking about there.
Well, clearly you played on a treadmill. That bit was obvious. Is it the
achievement
to advancement?
Why would you play it on a treadmill?
You could feel like you were really running in the game, I guess. I think it's a joke, isn't it? I don't think you actually played it on a treadmill.
I don't
Maybe
know.
He,
there's no smiley faces or anything, so.
If it's not got a smiley face on it, it's
so
not
we
a
can't
joke.
ascertain.
LMAO, I'm only mid 30s. How old do you think we are?
Chris is obviously 93.
Yeah, obviously I'm 48 with this beard. Yeah, you know, but
he thinks that we're mid 40s.
Yeah, I am early 30s. So you're older than us. Ha ha.
Yes. Been alive for longer.
I think Sam's just turned, haven't you, just this year?
I was 30 last year.
Just turned. Losing momentum. Yeah. What else? What else? Come on.
I don't want to talk about the gravity gun.
No, we've talked about that every... That's why I've avoided it.
Yeah.
But what I do want to talk about is why more games haven't done things like that. Almost like Half-Life 2 got it so right from the outset that there's almost been no point.
I agree. That's exactly why. And I think
that doesn't make sense to me. That's not how game companies work. When something's quite popular, they go, let's just shove that out the door a lot and then we can try and
do you know how cerebral making those puzzles is, though? I mean, it takes a while for us to figure them out as gamers, a good while. But if you're someone who's designing the game, you can, when you get yourself in a little bit of a bubble and go, is this actually complicated enough or interesting enough, or is it too obscure? For, you know, this is a game designer's problem, a puzzle designer in general. And there's loads of different techniques you can use to design puzzles. But I think Portal has something very, very unique and beautiful about it. And I don't think the context of Portal...
Talk could... about the graffiti gun.
Yeah, I don't... Sorry?
We'll talk about the graffiti gun before, not Portal.
Shit, I thought you were talking about the Portal gun.
Well, the Portal gun does actually work like the gravity gun.
Not really. One of them picks up objects, one of them actually walks through portals.
No, the Portal gun can pick up objects.
it can do, I suppose.
No, it can't.
You can pick up boxes and stuff.
The Portal gun, you can't pick up
objects. Oh, no, I think you just pick them up with your hands, don't you? The Portal gun doesn't do that. Yeah.
No, you don't pick up stuff. The gravity gun picks up objects. The Portal gun just opens portals. That's all it does. You've got left and right click. Ones.
Yes, you're right.
I'm definitely right. Sure.
You can move the companion cube, but there's no like hands there, but it's implied that you're doing it with your hands when you pick up the companion cube.
Yeah, you press use E on my keyboard.
Right. Well, yeah, I was talking about the gravity gun, not the portal gun.
Sorry. I'll shut up then. What were you talking about it for?
Well, I just mentioned it because, like I was saying, it's weird that it hasn't been replicated so much because, like Sam said, it's the sort of thing where a game does it and then sells a lot of copies because it does it, and everyone goes, right, we've got to do that for our game now. But it's almost like Half-Life 2 just nailed it so absolutely perfectly and didn't leave any room for anything more to do with it that no one could rip it off. Or maybe it was expect.
Maybe that's one of the reasons why Half-Life 3's never come out, because they're like, well, we can't do the gravity gun again unless we totally rework it. So what we're going to do with Half-Life 3 to make it better than Half-Life 2?
Do you think they're waiting for the next killer mechanic?
Maybe. I think they maybe are, because that would make sense to me that they probably have the opinion that because Half-Life 2 is so revered among gamers, that it's like, well, we can't release Half-Life 3 and not have it be better. And if it's not going to be better, then we better not release it at all. Because I will give that to Valve. I mean, they do a few sequels to games and stuff. But they generally seem to just be like, well, we want to release a good product. They seem to be their like highest priority rather than want to make loads of money off a product. It's like that product has to be good.
Valve are generally quite well respected for almost everything they do, pretty much, in the industry. They're obviously, they've got people who don't like them, and you know, there are some questionable things they do. I mean, the green light thing and the curating thing on Steam is always under the spotlight because people are involved generally. But yeah,
I get the feeling with Valve that they've taken a huge lesson from what happened to it, and that they don't want to rest on their laurels and keep re-releasing a kind of tried and tested formula. But I think Valve want to innovate in the same arena.
The same applies to the gravity gun that does when I was just kind of getting to my point with the portal gun. They're both put in a very specific context. The gravity gun was created by this scientist who was using it to do something specific. How many other ways can a gravity gun be created in a game? I mean, I'm sure there are people with imagination that could come up with this, but you know, you have to give it some context and give it some background before it can actually be used in a game, unless it's just an arbitrary gun that picks things up.
Interestingly, this is a mechanical thing, and this is something that that I've heard critics say about Bioshock Infinite with the Vigors, that the Vigors were kind of in that game because it was a Bioshock game and you expected them to be there, whereas in Bioshock, the first one, the plasmids were an integral part of not only the story but the world and everything. Like, the whole game was about that, whereas the Vigors are just powers that you've got in Bioshock Infinite. They're not really involved with the story. I mean, they sort of explained it a bit in the DLC that the Vigors come from plasmids, in that Fink was looking at Rapture through tears and saw the plasmids, and sort of the Vigors come from that. But it's still just not really connected to the main story. It's not anything to do with Elizabeth or Booker, is it? Whereas the plasmids and the whole Adam thing and how you make your choices with the little sisters was the entire like thing that Bioshock was. That's a weird thing of that's like a that mechanic felt like it was obligatory and not organic. Even though I love Bioshock Infinite, it's a great game. I can't deny that. The way they implemented the plasmids in the first Bioshock was completely organic. It felt like it's supposed to be there. It was part of the world, the story, the everything. It was organically introduced.
I've played Bioshock Infinite twice now and still haven't managed to complete it. I got like halfway through the first time, near the end the second time, but I just haven't come back to it.
You've done one and two though, haven't you?
No. I've barely played one and I didn't play two at all. Well, I got bored of one.
Wow. Don't bother with Infinite if you haven't played one and two. They're better games.
Yeah, one. I would say one is aged a bit, but it's still a better game than Infinite.
I know the ending to one now, it's all spoiled.
Doesn't matter, this game is still an amazing experience in general. They're brilliant. I want to play them again, actually.
There's a lot of great moments in Bioshock 1. There's a lot of really cool atmospheric... It's the little moments that aren't that people don't talk about because they're not Andrew Ryan being killed with the golf club. There's loads of great moments in that game. Like the first time you meet... what is that? The splicer that can teleport? The first time you meet one of them, and it's like it's just shadows appearing behind you, and you're like, you turn around and there's no one there. There's loads of really cool, like creepy bits in the game like that. It's a great game. It's such
like
a good
horror
game.
Thriller type thing, isn't it?
It's tense. There's a lot of tension.
Lots of tension. I really enjoyed that about Bioshock. Again, brilliant games, but I mean, don't try playing Infinite if you haven't. If you haven't played
I've
one,
I've nearly completed it now. But I played one, but I just didn't get into it. I didn't like the Big Daddy fights. I thought they were very laborious.
They are a bit. There's no denying that.
I'll give you that. But I can live with them to get past it.
Yeah, and they when you get later on in the game, the way that Big Daddies are used within the game becomes more interesting. You get different powers that you can start manipulating them, and you also get some really cool weapons that you can. Like, you can set traps for them and get them to chase you, and then, like, they'll run into your traps and you get to kill them a bit more quickly and easily once you get... There's a bit more tactics involved.
But it's another one of those... It's another one of those games that gives you lots of options, you know, lots of ways to kill people, and that was one of the main things that they sold about it in terms of the plasmid and, you know, Bioshock 2 specifically, where you could have the plasmid and your gun and you can quickly switch between everything. But it's still... did you not find yourself using the same thing, the same mechanic over and over again? You know, you didn't...
There were certain ones that I favoured. Obviously, the shotgun electro bolt, you know, was a really good combo. And it is still in Bioshock Infinite. The shotgun electro bolt's a really good combo.
So is this perpetuation across every AAA game of lots and lots of different ways to play the game? Because it seems to be becoming quite popular now. You know, talking about the Dishonors, the Bioshocks, the Assassin's Creeds, and they've all got all these tools in them, but quite often I find myself sticking to one particular tool, one particular mechanic, or a very small selection of them.
Yeah.
And I do the same. I did the same in Deus Ex. I did the same in every other game that gave me choice, pretty much. Yeah. And even when I replay those games, it's very, very rare that I would come in and replay them a different way. I play them the way that I want to play them. But is this, the reason I bring this up, is the perpetuation across the industry to sell more games, or is it because it's become expected of a game, or is it, you know, to sell more games so the game appeals to more people? It's like making a movie with everything in it, you know? Is that what it's for, or is it because the game developers are like, that's actually a really cool mechanic, let's throw it in there? Or are the AAAs actually making these decisions to sell more?
I think the AAAs are making a decision to sell more. I think the AAA has to basically... They can't afford to appeal to a very niche market because they're putting so much money into it. You know, you don't have the ability, really, unless you're an indie developer, to make a game which will appeal to a small... minority of the market that's out there. So they're kind of stuck in a situation where if they want to make a AAA title that's beautiful and sprawling, then they have to make it very accessible.
Arguably, as an indie developer, though, you don't want to restrict your market either, because you want to sell as many as you can, because you need to sell as many as you can, because you don't make as much money as a AAA. So there's no real reason and there's a lot of indies that do put things in games because they want to make money out of them, not because they think it's a good mechanic. Not all indies have total freedom of expression. As much as you'd like to think they do, they still unfortunately have to restrict themselves or be disciplined about what they put in the games because they need to sell it.
Not all indie developers are also, you know, artists that should be revered. There probably are some indie developers that are just as much of a knobhead as the people behind AAA games in their own way. They just like, I want to make some money. Computer games make a lot of money. Let's do that. There'll be quite a few of them like that. You've seen some indie games that are like that.
Most of those people with that particular personality, and there are, again, a few. I've met a few in person as well, that they go to mobile games. And they'll churn out the next Candy Crush, or they'll churn out the next Flappy Bird, or they'll just do a copy of it and make enough to kind of get by. And a lot of these people who do mobile games, they do that. They do sell plenty of copies, and they make a good living off it. It's not something I want to do personally, because I want to do a game that I want to do. You know, I prefer to do better games than I'm doing, but you know, I prefer to add more into the game, but I can't because of resources.
Fair enough.
So, on that note, unless anyone else has anything specific they want to talk about, I think we shall call it a night.
I can't think of anything.
No,
I think I'm good.
I'm sure we've missed out lots and lots of mechanics from lots of games and lots of tools and cool things that have gone on.
I think maybe we need to revisit this at some point.
I think, to be fair, we could have an entire show talking about stealth mechanics, because we were on that for a good portion of time.
Yeah.
And I think
there's lots of them are out there as well.
Yeah, and I think there's a lot more things. We're all into those games as well. You know, we're into lots of different types of games. I mean, there's all kinds of mechanics, isn't there? I mean, look at there's the survival kind of mechanic that you get in games. It's quite popular these days with your Don't Starves and your even your FTLs of the world. And that zombie game I was playing. State of Decay.
State of Decay.
You know, they're not similar in any respect, you know, all those three games that I've just mentioned, but they've all got kind of a survival, stay alive type mechanic in them, and you know, it's different again. We could just talk about that, but I think we need to have a chat about next week's show and see what subject we come up with.
Yeah,
hopefully with Steve back as well.
Yes, hopefully, fingers crossed. And
I'll drag him around here if he can't get his internet sorted.
Yeah, as long as you don't have the problems of last time and you don't spend the entire session ordering a pizza. Like you did last time. Right, so yes, thanks for everyone watching. We shall see you at 7:30 next Wednesday. And in the meantime, we'll be... We're a bit behind with the Metal Gear Solid stuff at the moment, but we'll get on that as soon as we can. And we'll hopefully have one for you next Monday. But thanks a lot for watching, everyone, and we'll see you later.
See you later. Bye-bye.